and show us to those who pray with us the riches of your tender mercy. For to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is due all glory, honor, and worship, now and ever and forever.
Oh God. from birth. His disciples asked Jesus, Rabbi, was it his sin or that of his parents that caused him to be blind? Neither answered Jesus, it was no sin either of this man or of his parents. Rather, it was to let God's work show forth in him. We must do the deeds of him who sent me while it is day. Night comes on when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. With that, Jesus spat on the ground, made mud with his saliva, smeared the man's eyes with the mud, and he told him, go wash in the pool of Siloam. His name means one who had been sent. So the man went off and washed and came back able to see. His neighbors and the people who had been accustomed to see him begging asked him, isn't this the fellow who used to sit and beg? Some were claiming it was he, others maintained it was not, but someone who looked like him. The man himself said, I am the one. They said to him then, how were your eyes opened? He answered, that man they called Jesus made mud and smeared into my eyes, telling me to go to Siloam and wash. When I did go and wash, I was able to see. Where is he? They asked. He replied, I have no idea. Next they took the man who had been born blind to the Pharisees. Note that it was on a Sabbath that Jesus made the mud basin open his eyes. The Pharisees, in turn, began to inquire how he had recovered his sight. He told them he put mud in my eyes, washed it off, and now I can see. This prompted some of the Pharisees to assert, this man cannot be from God because he does not keep the Sabbath. Others objected, if a man is a sinner, how can he perform signs like these? They were sharply divided over Jesus. Then they addressed the blind man again. Since it was you whose eyes he opened, what do you have to say about him? He is a prophet, he replied. The Jews refused to believe that he had really been born blind and begun to see until they summoned the parents of the man who could see. Is this your son, they asked? And if so, do you attest that he was blind at birth? How do you account from the fact that he can see? The parents answered, we know this is our son, and we know he was blind at birth. But how he can see now, or who opened his eyes, we have no idea. Ask him. He is old enough to speak for himself. His parents answered in this fashion because they were afraid of the Jews, who had already agreed among themselves that anyone who acknowledged Jesus as the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. That is why his parents said, he is of age, ask him. A second time they summoned the man who had been born blind and said to him, give glory to God. First of all, we know this man is a sinner. I do not know whether he is a sinner or not, he answered. I know this much. I was blind before, now I can see. They persisted. Just what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? I have told you once, but you will not listen to me, he answered them. Why do you want to hear it all over again? Do not tell me you want to become his disciples too. They retorted scornfully, you are the one. Who is that man's disciple? You are the disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, and we have no idea where this man comes from. The man came back at them. Well, this is news. You do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not hear sinners, but if someone is devout and obeys his will, he listens to him. It is unheard of that anyone ever gave sight to a person blind from birth. If this man were not from God, he could not have done such a thing. What they exclaimed, you are steeped in sin from your birth, and you are giving us lectures. With that, they threw him out bodily. When Jesus heard of the expulsion, he sought the man out and asked him, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, who is he, sir? And I may believe in him. Jesus replied, you have seen him, and he is speaking to you now. I do believe, Lord, he said, and bowed down to worship him.
Glory to you, O Lord.
You know, this miracle described in today's gospel is even
blind people receiving sight, but this is something that's completely unprecedented. Jesus placed clay in the man's empty sockets and told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam. And when he obeyed these instructions, the eyes of clay became living eyes. And when we look at this miraculous healing of Christ, we can see a general pattern. Usually the healing occurs after a certain person or a close friend or relative approaches Jesus to seek healing, such as the nobleman in Capernaum, the centurion's servant, and Jairus. At other times, it involves Jesus asking the sick person or the advance of a question like, do you want to be healed? As with the paralytic 2 weeks ago. What do you want me to do for you? As the blind man in Luke's gospel. Only very occasionally, such as in today's gospel, does Jesus heal the sick man with no prior demonstration of desire on their part. The blind man did not ask Jesus to restore sight, nor did Jesus ask him if he wanted to be made well. In fact, the blind man seems to have very little faith or knowledge of who really Jesus Christ is. And when he's questioned by his neighbors about the restoration of his sight, the blind man does not credit his own faith or Jesus as the Messiah. He knows the name of Jesus, but he does not know where Jesus is. You know, I want to ask a question. Does it sound familiar to you? Especially when we're sick or in ill health. When we're sick or in ill health, we either get well or we go to a doctor for treatment and we recover. During our sickness and healing, we have little or no awareness of the presence in Christ and his divine power. People may ask how he got better, but seldom is there a mention of Jesus Christ in any of them. Just like the blind man in today's gospel, we are called to reflect upon our experiences of healing and understand the presence and involvement of Christ in these miraculous events. After being questioned by the neighbors, the blind man was brought before the Pharisees. Those religious leaders are only focusing on finding the person who violated the Sabbath. When they ask the man, what do you say about him? Because he opens your eyes. And the blind man answers, he's a prophet. The faith of the blind man is certainly growing. He does not stay with his original answer, but now he acknowledges that a man from God, and thus God himself, was involved in this miraculous healing. And the Pharisees continued to pressure the blind man in order to call Jesus a sinner so that they can discredit him and his works. But the blind man remains resolute. The Pharisees already knew about Jesus, and they were obviously intimidating the people to disavow and denounce him as the Messiah. And the blind man's parents were afraid of being put out of the synagogue. Even after the Pharisees reviled him, the man who was once blind and a beggar now speaks with boldness about Jesus Christ, saying, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing. Too often we react as the parents of the blind man and are afraid to acknowledge Christ as our Lord and Savior and healer in our life because we do not want to be perceived as being naive, blind, or too religious, as zealots. We're afraid that we might be shunned from certain social or professional groups. Although doctors and nurses and health professionals are very, very important in healing people, we must never forget that all healing, great and small, is a gift from God. We participate to various degrees in that healing, but ultimately, it's of divine origin. If we are courageous enough to confess Christ as the physician and healer of our souls and bodies, and it causes us to be marginalized by our friends, our colleagues, and perhaps even our own family, what then can we do? The blind man was driven out of the synagogue, and then Jesus went to seek him out and find him, and ask him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" If we remain resolute and faithful, even if we don't understand everything or how it really fits together in God's plan, Jesus Christ will seek us out and find us and ask us to trust in him even more. The journey of faith is in some sense infinite, but the object of our belief, Christ our God, will always be walking right next to us. In a way, we are all part of a generation of people born blind. Some of us were born outside the faith of the Lord. According to an ancient plan, our spiritual eyes should have remained closed until our very death. And millions upon millions of people would have gone to eternity without ever knowing God, or their own souls, or even the spiritual world all by itself. Everything was done to ensure that we, born blind from parents who were to one another extent also born blind, would remain that way forever. But God worked a miracle in us without asking us whether we believe or not, without tormenting us over this question, although knowing that this faith was not in us. The Lord anointed us. He anointed us with clay as with holy myrrh, and millions upon millions of people have been healed. Their spiritual eyes were opened. Through the centuries, blind people who were healed, like the man blind from birth, were subjected to difficult trials, interrogations, torture, death, mockery by the Pharisees of their time, and many were cut off from their friends and relatives. What happened to them and happened to this blind man from birth in the Gospels happened to many of us. Today's Gospel shows us how a man born blind has become someone who saw and became a faithful confessor of Jesus Christ, while many of the educated Pharisees who could see with their physical eyes remained in their spiritual blindness, refusing to believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, and they still believe that today. Therefore, we see that God can turn a disabled person into a teacher, into a missionary, a man sent by him into the world. My dear brothers and sisters, this is why we confess together with the blind man healed that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus became man out of love for humanity and for our salvation, and enlightened by grace of Jesus, we pray to him, the one with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Christos was risen.
Lord, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have
death and eternal life by your grace. We pray, O generous Creator of all, hear and have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
And we pray for the people here present, who are waiting for great and abundant mercy, for those who chose mercy, and for all Christians in the true faith.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Trinity, one in essence, and from the Father.
candles, bottles, confessions, ascetics, and every just spirit, laughter, and sympathy, especially for our most holy roses, you are the most blessed and glorious lady, the very bold
on his
these days, O invisible King, for by your visible power you have fashioned all things, and in the greatness of your mercy have brought all things out of non-existence into being. Look down from heaven, O Master, upon those who bow their heads to you, for they do not bow with flesh and blood, but to you, the awesome God. Therefore, O Master, make smooth for the good of all the path that lies ahead, according to the need of each. Sail with those who sail, travel with those who travel, cure those who are sick, O physician of souls and bodies. Good and grace and mercies and the loving kindness of your only begotten Son, with whom you are blessed, together with your only good and life-creating Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Sins and have mercy on me. O Lord, forgive me for our sins without our knowledge.
have given us a perfect representation of your death and resurrection. Through them, keep us in your sanctification and remembrance of your grace always, saving us by your death and resurrection. Grant that those who celebrate with us and serve your divine mysteries may serve well in their order and have full confidence before your fearful tribunal. For you are the true God and eternal life, and to you we give glory, together with the Father and the Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Fathers and mothers and families, and also the ought Sunday, June the 19th. There are two sign-up sheets just to give us an idea of how many people we should prepare for. I don't know if you saw that when we were walking in the back vestibule by the chapel or when you're exiting the church going out by the gift store, but please take a look at those two sign-up sheets. Put your name down there and the number of people that are attending, okay? And so I hope that you have a safe and beautiful week, and I hope that we see you on Ascension Thursday, and that's going to be when, Christy?
Thursday
at 7 o'clock. Glory to you, O Christ, turn all our own glory to you.
Christ is risen.
He granted us.